Cool. Hello, everyone. Today I'm going to talk about the power of CoreDNS, and more specifically about a plugin deep dive and how you can create your own plugin. I also need to mention that there's the Beamer is a bit buggy, so it's not my presentation, but it's the Beamer. Short introduction. My name is Terrence Risse. I'm a lead developer at Security Hive. Previously worked at Weave for a few years, so I still see a lot of familiar faces. And in between Weave and Security Hive, I also did some freelancing as a Go developer. In total, I have about 4 years of Golang experience professionally, and before that used PHP mostly. In my spare time, I started training for the marathon recently. I did my first 16K. It's still a long way to go, but I'm proud of the first results. And I'm also a father of two, daughter Rosie and my son Frankie. It's my first time giving a talk like this, so obviously the nerves are there. And if there is any feedback, it's always welcome and we can always have a beer afterwards. So at Security Hive, we build cybersecurity products, and we do that using Golang. And we recently started working on a DNS security solution. And we didn't want to reinvent the wheel ourselves, so we looked for some other tools that could support us with providing DNS. And in our research, we encountered CoreDNS. And the nice thing about CoreDNS is that it has a really flexible plugin system, and I was really hooked by from the beginning, and that's why I started using it. The agenda for today, first going to dive into CoreDNS. What is DNS? I think most of everyone knows DNS, but I'm just going to scratch the surface a little bit. Then we're going to look at how you can use CoreDNS. And then we're going to look at the plugin architecture, so how does it look like from a high level. And then we are going to develop our own plugin. Sadly, it's not live. I've added some code snippets in between, and at the end I've also added the repository URL, which people can use afterwards. Finally, a few tips and tricks, but also a few cool plugins I've encountered. And yeah, that's it. So the main question, I think, what is CoreDNS? That's the main question we have. And in order to answer that, we first have to get back to what DNS is. And I saw this meme on Reddit, and it was really spot on, if you ask me. I think about a year ago, there was a big outage at Facebook. Was, I think, for even maybe a few hours. And the issue was DNS. And I myself have also had a lot of issues with DNS before. I think most of the developers that work with DNS also have a love-hate relationship sometimes with DNS. So DNS stands for Domain Name Server, and on a high level it is used to translate human-friendly names, domain names, to IP addresses. So we as humans do not have to enter Google, the IP address of google.com in our browser, but we can just go to Google. It is first created in the 1980s, since then it had a lot of updates. And in the most basic form, you can send queries using UDP, TCP over port 53. Since 1980, there's also been some updates related to DNS over HTTPS, DNS over TLS, and also DNS over gRPC and QUIC to add an extra layer of encryption. CoreDNS is a DNS server, so it's responsible for providing DNS. It's part of the Cloud Native Foundation, and it's mostly used as a replacement for your kubeDNS within your Kubernetes environment. It also has a few benefits compared to kubeDNS. That's why a lot of companies like to switch it up, but I'm not going to dive into that. That's maybe even something you can look at afterwards. You can also use it as a standalone DNS server within your home environment to do some ad blocking, which we're also going to do at the end. And some of the adopters that I found in the CoreDNS repository are SoundCloud, HelloFresh, Zalando. And the reason why it is so popular, already mentioned it, is due to its plugin system. And although it is about CoreDNS, I think the main message is how you can create your own plugin system, or even apply it to your own projects or use cases. If you want to use CoreDNS or install it, you can have a pre-compiled binary. You can also use a Docker image or build it from source. And in this example, I have the precompiled binary. I specify the port it needs to run on, and using a dig command, I will receive the DNS response. It's really that easy. By default, it also has a few plugins precompiled. So I took this file from, not this file. Hopefully it comes back. Yes. I took this file from the CoreDNS repository. And they have a whole list of all the plugins that are available. And you can also add your own plugin at the bottom. Just clone the CoreDNS repository, run go generate and go build, and you have your binary with your custom plugin. But that doesn't mean that the plugins are also configured and available for usage. In order to do so, you need to create a core file. And, well, not this file again. You need to create a core file, and a core file contains multiple server blocks. Over here you have the format of a server block, and at the bottom you also have an example. A server block, you can have multiple as mentioned, and CoreDNS will spawn multiple servers if multiple server blocks are configured. A single server block needs to have a scheme. By default it is DNS, which means UDP or TCP. But it can also be HTTPS, TLS, gRPC, and all the other protocols. You then need to specify the zone. I'm not going to dive too deep on that, but in the example at the bottom, we are going to listen on the root zone. And it comes back. And we're going to listen on port 53. And if we run this core DNS instance and receive a DNS request on port 53, we have two plugins configured, the log and the forward. And if we receive a request, it goes through the log first, then it will go to the forward plugin, and it will it's just a DNS proxy. And we're going to forward it to the Cloudflare DNS. Very simple. The core file, I don't know if people are familiar with the Keddy HTTP server, but the core file is just a fork from the Keddy file. And the Keddy HTTP server is also a very popular Go project, also entirely written in Go. I've also added a URL to look at afterwards. Very cool project. And one cool thing, it's the CoreDNS or the core file supports a reload plugin. And once it starts CoreDNS, you can just make changes to the core file and it will just hot reload a new configuration while still serving DNS requests. And already mentioned, you can have multiple server blocks to spin up multiple servers on different ports and different configurations. Each plugin can have its own configuration. So we just saw a few slides back that we used the forward plugin just to forward our DNS request to Cloudflare and eventually parse back the response. But as you can see, you can configure much more. And that is the nice thing of the Keddy file and the core files, that you can really specify the parameters that you need for your plugin to run. So that's just the basics of CoreDNS, and I think it's now time to create a plugin ourselves. On a high level, the plugin architecture has three parts. The first part is the registration part. That is where we are going to connect our plugin with CoreDNS. The second part is the setup. And that is responsible for parsing the core file configuration and converting it to Go types that we want to use for our plugin. And the third part, that's where the magic happens. There we need to implement the plugin.handler interface, which I'm going to show to you guys. And that contains two methods, the name and the serve DNS. And that's where we are going to place our logic. Once you have these three configured, you can just deploy it somewhere and people can hook it up with their core DNS configuration and start using it. So what are we going to build? I was thinking about a cool use case. Well, in this case, we're going to build an ad blocker, a really, really simple one. I'm using the oisd.nl file, which contains ad and tracker domains, just a small txt file with all the domains listed in there. And if we find a domain or we send out a request where the domain is inside of that list, we are going to log the entry. And we are also going to modify the reply to return 0.0.0.0 so that it's not resolvable in the browser. So first, the registration part. Try to make it as big as possible. So I think it is visible at the bank at the back. In the registration part, we are currently go from top to bottom. We are in the add blocker package, and we have a setup.go file. And at the top, we have an init function that is used to register our plugin. And what it really says is, once in the core file you encounter the add blocker name, you need to call the setup function. It's not visible right now, it will be in the next slide, but this is just to connect the core file with our plugin configuration. At the bottom, I've created a plug struct, which contains the next attribute, which will be the next plugin that we need to call. It's a plugin chaining mechanism. The second parameter, that's the blocklist parameter, that will be the file that we are going to specify in our core file. And at the bottom, we have the block entries, which will just load all the domains into a map for quick lookup. Now we're going to look at the setup part. So once we specify that we want to use the ad blocker, and the core file detects that it has the ad blocker plugin configured, then it will call this setup function. At the top, we initialize the plug struct. In the second part, that is where we are going to parse our core file configuration. That's this part. And it's just fairly simple. We are going to receive the file that we need to load, so it will just be the first argument. But just with the forward plugin that we just saw, you can go really complex with the configuration that a plugin needs. I left out the parsing of the domains since it's not that important, but it's just a TXT file with on each new line a domain specified. At the bottom is the most important. This is the place where we are going to return our plug struct, and it needs to conform to the plugin.handler interface. And we also specify the next plugin that will be afterwards, after us. That's the setup part. And now we need to implement the plugin.handler interface. And in this example, I go through it from top to bottom again. You will receive a W for the response writer back to the client. The R is for the DNS message that, that the user sent, the client sent to us. And in this example, we're just going to pick the first question. So the previous dig amount you saw, it will be google.com, for example. Then we're just going to look it up into our map. And if it is specified, then we're going to send back a reply in which we set the A record to IPv0. Yes. So that's where we're going to modify the reply, and we eventually are going to write it back to the client and return our response code. If it is not in the map, then we are just going to hand it over to the next plugin, so to keep that chaining mechanism. If you have these three, you can just deploy it somewhere. Pretty much the ad blocker plugin is now finished, but we still need to hook it up and start using it. So in this example, I've extended the CoreDNS a CoreDNS repository, created a main.go file, and I will again go through it from top to bottom. First, we need to silently import our plugin, so it will be included into our binary. It's pretty much like the plugin.cfg file that we saw at the beginning. And here we need to specify all the plugins that are available. Here we also need to specify the name, and this part is very important because this will decide the order in which the plugins will be called. And finally, at the bottom, we just have to hand over our plugins to CoreDNS, and we can just call core main.run, and it will start our DNS server. But that's not it. We also need to modify the core file. So we specify that we want to use the ad blocker, and we want to use the OISD file. Almost, yes. And we want to use the OISD file. And eventually, if we're not blocking the request, then we want to forward it to the Google DNS. It's really a simple DNS proxy. Now, if we run our main file, in this case, example, I made a tiny mistake. I just noticed it's listening on port 54. But it can also be any port, obviously. And if we execute a dig command to a domain that is on the list, you will see that we are blocking the response. And I left it out because it was taking too much space, but in the DNS response, you would see that it will be it will resolve to 0.0.0.0. And that's really a simple ad blocker. You can make it much more complex. In the CoreDNS repository, you can also look at some other cool plugins that are available and how they did a few things. And finally, a few tips and tricks. If you want to use logging, it's pretty much best practice to use the log package from CoreDNS, so everything is in the same style but also has the same configuration. A few cool plugins that I've used myself, obviously, is the reload plugin I just mentioned before. Also, the errors plugin, which makes your debugging obviously a lot easier. You can also use the cache plugin, which will enable local cache. And there's also a default GeoIP plugin, which will add GeoIP data based on the client IP that is sending the request. And if you want to take a look at the repository, maybe even try it out yourselves, here's the link as well. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for having me. Are there any questions? Yeah.
To see how you would implement the plugin system yourself, right?
Yeah, correct.
So how has this influenced how you guys created your own plugin?
Yeah, so how your question is, I need to repeat it, otherwise it's not on the recorder. Your question is how CoreDNS influenced our decision making, right? If I'm correct? CoreDNS, well, at first we were looking at a few DNS packages, and there are a lot. There's a very popular one from Mika G, if I'm correct, that's also used within CoreDNS. And first off, we tried to really build our DNS server around that. But at a certain point, we were really developing a lot ourselves. And once we saw that there was CoreDNS, that took the whole responsibility from us with resolving DNS, and also had a few default plugins available which we could use, like for example the caching. So at that moment we really wanted to start with CoreDNS first, and based on how we've used it so far, it really provides us also with some testing functionality. So yeah, up to this point it was a positive influence. Yeah. Yeah.
You didn't mention DNSSEC.
Yeah, so there's a DNSSEC plugin also by default available, which you can enable. I think next time, maybe it's also a recommendation to you guys to look at the plugin section on the CoreDNS website. There is a shitload of plugins which you can use, but the DNSSEC is one of them, correct? Yeah.
Pizza.
I think that's the answer. All right, thanks everyone.